For being with us on a Friday afternoon, and welcome to the sixth edition of one of our flagship programs, the Bengal Chamber Leadership Lecture Series. Your chamber commenced its leadership lecture series in 2017 with Dr. Montek Singh Aluwalia, followed by Dr. Shashi Tharoor in 2018, Mr. Saurav Ganguly in 2019, Dr. R. S. Sodhi, Chairman Amul in 2021, and Mr. Sanjeev Sanyal in March 2022. Having covered the India's economy through Dr. Aluwalia, we had Dr. Tharoor speak on the new India, while Saurav Ganguly spoke on leadership and team building, while Dr. R. S. Sodhi shared the success mantra of Amul, one of India's most iconic brands, and Mr. Sanyal spoke about the art of policymaking in uncertain times. Before we proceed, I would like to express the Bengal Chamber's sincere gratitude to JIS Group, The Telegraph, our media partners, RT Network Solutions, Tax Connect, and Response India, our creative partners for the program, along with 6 Baliganj Place, for extending their kind support in making this event happen. Thank you all. The idea of our leadership lecture series this year is not to listen to someone giving a speech to the audience, but instead to create a space where some eminent Kolkatans can engage in a candid discussion and conversation with someone who has been a pioneer in this field, Dr. Purnendu Chatterjee, founder chairman of the multi-billion dollar conglomerate, the Chatterjee Group. Besides, we also have a most special and emotive task to perform, about which you will hear more from our president, Mr. Abraham Stefanos. Won't take any more of your time and would request Mr. Abraham Stefanos, president of the Bengal Chamber, to please commence the session formally with his welcome address. Sir, kindly come on stage, please. Thank you.
Dr. Purnendu Chatterjee, former presidents of the Bengal Chamber, members of the Managing Committee, ladies and gentlemen, thank you all for being with us here today. In the introduction, you heard about the leadership lecture series, but we also have a different event today, which we have been waiting for 3 years to actually have physically. This is the Igniting Minds Award. We will be presenting Dr. Purnendu Chatterjee with the Bengal Chamber Sardar Jodh Singh Award for Igniting Minds. This is an award that the Chamber instituted in 2019. Dr. Chandrasekhar Ghosh of Bandhan Bank was the first recipient. We have been wanting to give this award to Dr. Chatterjee for the past several years, but because COVID intervened, he was physically not available in Kolkata. And when we got this opportunity, we decided to take full advantage of his presence, not only in handing over this award, but also hearing his views as part of the leadership lecture series. The Igniting Minds Award was instituted to recognize inspiring leadership in any field. And there is no doubt that Dr. Purnendu Chatterjee is an inspiring leader. The concept of leadership itself has evolved and changed in the past couple of decades. It is not only leadership in business, it is leadership in stakeholder governance, issues like diversity, ESG, have become integral parts of leadership responsibility. And in Dr. Chatterjee, as we all know, we see a leader who's not confined to a narrow space or a narrow geography, but a truly international leader with several creditable achievements. I think we will find out more about that during the lecture series. But today, I am very happy that Dr. Chatterjee is here with us to receive this award for setting global benchmarks in corporate growth and passionately promoting entrepreneurship and research. This is planned to be an annual award and a most prestigious award which the Bengal Chamber bestows on an iconic personality every year. The awardee would have played a role as a true visionary and leader, cutting across business, cultural, philanthropic or social spheres, and stands for values and ethics that have helped in igniting minds of Indians. Dr. Chatterjee has inspired India Inc. and made us proud in the global arena. So, I thank you all again for joining us on this momentous occasion and welcome you to a very stimulating discussion that lies ahead. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Sir, I would request the president to be on the stage, please, sir. Sir, kindly be on stage, please. I would also like to welcome Mr. Shubhi Chakraborty, President Designate, the Bengal Chamber, and Mr. Taranjit Singh, Managing Director, GIS Group, to come up on the dais, please. The Bengal Chamber Igniting Minds Award is named after Sardar Jodh Singh, a visionary and far-sighted personality who had always aspired to bring about a positive transformation in the society by educating minds. Apart from education, Sardar Jodh Singh also developed industries in various sectors like dairy, cargo, telecom, infrastructure, etc. His hard work and progressive activities have led to the global eminence of GIS Group, which has generated employment to more than 22,000 people in the recent years. May we have Dr. Purnendu Chatterjee, founder chairman, the Chatterjee Group, on the dais, please. Ladies and gentlemen, we request you to kindly put your hands together and give him a standing ovation. Dr. Purnendu Chatterjee, founder chairman of the Chatterjee Group, is a man who truly does not need any introduction. However, perhaps only to bask in his glory, let us share few glimpses of the man and his world, that is TCG. A graduate from Indian Institute of Technology, Kharagpur, and MSc and PhD in Industrial Engineering and Operations Research from the University of California, Berkeley, he was also a partner at McKinsey. Under Dr. Chatterjee's leadership, TCG has garnered over three decades of experience in operating companies and business spanning continents and verticals. An entrepreneur and educationist at heart, Dr. Chatterjee is one of the primary founders of the Indian School of Business and believes in promoting entrepreneurship and research as a key to India's leap forward. May we request the President of the Chamber, Mr. Abraham Stefanos, President Designate Mr. Shubhi Chakraborty and Mr. Taranjit Singh, Chief Patron, to kindly present the Igniting Minds Awards to Dr. Purnendu Chatterjee.
We'll be right back. your hands in the air.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sirs.
Thank you.
Thank you. Sir, please take your seat. As we go into the second part of our program today, we would now have Mr. Oniruddho Lahiri, former president, the Bengal Chamber, in the dais. Kindly please. An alumnus of IIT Chennai, Mr. Lahiri started off his career with Mephityle Group before moving on for a three-decade-long journey with Unilever, where he held global roles across various supply chain, corporate affairs, human resources, and other functions. Returning to India in 2001, Mr. Lahiri joined ABB Group as its MD and CEO, and under Mr. Lahiri's stewardship, ABB saw unprecedented growth and expanded its footprint to the electronic media, starting with the acquisition of Star News from Star TV portfolio owned by News Corp. Mr. Lahiri was also president of the Chatterjee Group, working in close unison with Dr. Chatterjee between 2006 to 2014. He is also an entrepreneur and now focuses on engineering, design services, and training. He is also a former president of the Bengal Chamber of Commerce and Industry and the Calcutta Management Association. Mr. Lahiri has also served as the chairman of the Board of Practical Training as a nominee of the Ministry of Human Resources Development, Government of India. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Dr. Chatterjee and Mr. Lahiri, please. Thank you. Would request Mr. Lahiri to please take the session forward. Thank you, sir.
Voice, if God's given me anything, he's given me a very loud voice. So welcome, PC, a warm welcome from all of us here, Bengal Chambers. And first of all, let me congratulate you for receiving this award, Igniting Minds. And as Abe said, and the president said, we've been waiting for a very, very long time, for this opportunity when we could give you this award. Now, today, ladies and gentlemen, is all about Dr. Purnendu Chatterjee, popularly known as PC to his friends and associates. Now, in the introduction that came earlier, much has been said about his role, and Abe, you talked about that too. So as the founder and chairman of Chatterjee Group, TCG that is, the New York-based multinational with a diverse range of investments in petrochemicals, information technology, life sciences, real estate, process technology, high-end education, and research. PC doesn't really need an introduction. So the predicament I am faced with is, how do you introduce a person who needs no introduction? But nevertheless, I will try and leave as much time as possible to PC to tell us about the quiet human, you know, the unassuming human behind this behind this prolific investor. So with an enviable academic track record, which has been already said, but I'll repeat, mechanical engineering at IIT Kharagpur, master's and PhD from UC Berkeley, research associate at Stanford. PC is a real trailblazer as a business leader. He's leveraged a unique background combining management consulting and international investment. The group is just into just about everything that you can think of. Now, going back to, you know, Bolpur, where he was born. So from Bolpur to New York, it has been a long and indeed very interesting journey. And one which is riddled with very many contradictions. The daily egg white omelette and toast for breakfast, and his favorite spicy chanachur, which is most appreciated Johnny Walker Black Label, are savored in equal measure. Again, contradictions galore. Now, you know, I recall a small incident which I would like to share with you. You know, this is a hilarious exchange with a very senior bureaucrat who happened to have met PC back in the day. I asked him after a few hours after the meeting was over, and the meeting had in fact the chief minister of the state also. So I asked him whether the meeting was useful. Rather exasperatedly, he explained, and pardon me, I will say this in Bengali, but I'll translate that for some of you who may not understand, who are not so familiar with Bengali, although I doubt whether there's anybody. So he said to me, he responded by saying, "Onek kichu to bole gelen, kintu kichui bujhte parlam na. Pore phese jabo na to." So this is PC, you know, way ahead of times, and people really take time sometimes to understand what is going through his mind and what he is talking about, you know. Now to go back into, you know, I really don't want this to be some kind of an interview, you see. I want it to be a fun session, adda, and a little bit of fun for everybody. Now, let me ask you a few questions. And PC, if there's any question that you do not wish to answer or do not wish to share your answer with, then we'd be very glad to know that, you know. I mean, not for sure. Not short of sight, though. Not short of sight. Okay. Now, PC, not much is known about your school days in Ramakrishna Mission, Narendrapur. How have the values, one has heard a lot about the values of Ramakrishna Mission and so forth, and indeed they are very, very cherished. How have the values learnt in Narendrapur shaped you to be the person that you are today?
Thank you, Ani, for nice words to get to this question. কোথায় যে ফাঁসাবে আমি জানি না এখনো বাট দ্যাটস ইফ নট ইউ হু রাইট সো আই এম ফুললি প্রিপেয়ার্ড ফর অল ইয়োর কোয়েশ্চেন্স অ্যান্ড আনসার দেম অ্যাজ ট্রুথফুলি অ্যাজ আই ক্যান বাট বিফোর আই স্টার্ট আনসারিং দ্যাট কোয়েশ্চেন I really want to thank the Bengal Chamber of Commerce and Industry for honoring me with this award. Truly touched by the sentiment expressed, as you said, before the award, they wanted to give it to me. And I feel that, you know, I'm not very good at post-award acknowledgments, because I feel very touched by it. Because school, award for award, which you pass, that's not. So then, we robust to have it. Education, Bhalachilam, but not like Amartya Babu, never got the first boy syndrome in me. So, lack of that, maybe the reason, maybe many other things that you'll speculate or I speculate, but I'm always reticent about getting awards. Particularly when award has such an interesting name, Igniting Minds. And I was thinking about who all have ignited minds that I know of. Obviously, Swami Vivekananda, because of the school I come from, ignited many minds. Sri Ramakrishna ignited his mind. And there are many examples that you may find in the history books. But in recent days, such comparisons to Jesus Christ or Swami Vivekananda are very rare. So I step back from it as to why, and it may have something to do with our Hindu philosophy. Whose mind? Who does our mind belong to? And can you ignite any mind? To me, all minds are ignited. They are in state of ignition today. Because it's all one mind. If one mind is ignited, all minds are ignited. It's like quantum entanglement. They're all entangled with each other. So, think. And we may develop this more as the discussion progresses. I think it's a very, very important award, but at the same time, the award has a lot of deeper meaning inside it when you use the word mind. So, with that said, I'm sure the people that selected me for the award had a hard time, and there are many criteria you had, so I appreciate the hard work that they have done and the committee for selecting me for this award. Thank you.
That's very well said, PC, but you know, you talked about igniting minds in the award which you just received. We wanted to know a bit about the values of cherished values, the famous values of Ramakrishna. What are these values that have shaped you?
Yeah, so, you know, the values in this long journey, I left Ramakrishna Mission in 66. That's what, 56 years back. So I'm sure in that path, many, many things has happened where those values have come and guided me. But one of the things that I can reflect back today is, you know, I've generated a lot of wealth, okay, during this long journey. Then I ask myself, who does the money belong to? And at the end of the day, I feel this doesn't belong to me. I've just been a custodian of this wealth. And so, what I've decided to do is not be touched by the money I generated. So, practice of detachment from everything, whether it's a success in business or the success that led to the money, you know, I kind of try as much as possible to stay detached. Only place where I have not practiced detachment, but maybe it helps me, is Ujjala Chanachur or Black Label Whiskey. So that may be a detachment that I have to practice a little bit more.
So, PC, that was typical of you, the answer. But, you know, are you talking about Thakurer, you know, the Taka Mati syndrome? And Taka and Mati are the same. But I know that you had another interpretation of it, you know, of Thakur's, you know, this example he gave of Taka and Mati being the same. You had another interpretation, didn't you?
Well, if you look at real estate businesses, Mati is Taka.
Right. So that's true. Huh? And today it's actually Mati is Taka, everything is Mati. Huh? Right. Now, you see, coming nearer home, who in your family influenced you the most? And why? You know, having lost your father very early in your life, you know, who was actually your anchor?
Yeah.
Who gave you the yes. Guru Mantra?
Very simple. It is my mother. Unquestionable, my mother, not only by her deeds, but also what she has said. Even now, I remember and time to time saying, Amai ma bolten, je, kothay kotha bare. So if you get into an uncomfortable discussion, you see the temperature is going up, you have to find a way that you come back to that topic later on, not at the heat of the moment. So wow, a simple that's... example of how she has shaped in every situation I've been to, I try to remember that and saying, okay, don't get into a direct confrontation. You deal with it when that temperature is down. I wish some of the people in the world leadership had a mother like, they had a mother like my mother.
Wonderful. You see, that's a fantastic tribute, you know. Tribute to somebody's mother. I haven't really heard very many tributes of that nature. But I also know, I'm aware of, you know, the fact that you were very close to your sisters, and particularly one of them, right?
Yeah.
And is that, did they also influence you a lot?
Yeah, all my siblings.
All of your siblings.
All of my siblings in different ways. I'm the youngest of six. Okay. So all my siblings had plenty of opportunity to shape me. And so they did in words, kinds, and sometimes it is chot chapur mero. That's natural, right?
So being the youngest,
who do you beat up? If you always beat up the youngest one. So that's, you know, receptacle was being. But my sister who is now in Chicago, I think she influenced in very many ways in guiding my life, not to ensuring that, you know, there is good education, good values, and I go to America and do my higher studies there.
So, you know, you're a very principled person, PC. I'll come to that later. Very principled. And you'll give an arm and a leg, you know, to protect your principles. You've seen much of that. So, is this has this also come in through the influence of the family, you know, in the sense that you stand to your principles and never compromise?
I will not say I'm jidi, irokom. As you have sensed from before, yes, I don't wear my principle on my, you know, wrist, but I do have them. It comes from the village I come from, the family I come from, the way we have grown up. Also, it's a Bengali culture to some extent. You don't flaunt everything. Even your educational achievements, you keep it under wraps to the extent you can. What you have to do is to keep your mind become more and more curious and find more nuggets of wisdom from wherever you can. So I would not say that I am so principled that I'll fight for all causes that are out there. I fight for a few causes that are very important to me. That doesn't mean that other causes are not important to me, but I don't fight for them equally, because you have to choose how many things you can fight for or focus on. So tomorrow, even though I may feel a particular issue very, very important, I would not go and say, stand in the corner with a flag and saying, okay, let me fight for this cause. So I have to choose the battles based on where I can make an impact,
right?
Not all of them.
But PG, you know, being the youngest of the six siblings, you talked about how you were disciplined, but didn't that also contribute to your being spoiled? You know, the best sandesh kept aside, the best piece of fish left for you. You didn't have, you were not pandered into and spoiled.
I think there my mother's philosophy is again comes in. We're not from a wealthy family. I would say my father was a lawyer, so we were, you know, reasonably well off for putting food on the table. But it's not that rasogolla mangsho eshob sob shomoy prochondo porimane royeche. But jetukoni chilo, my mother made sure all six of us got
inequitably,
because sometimes boro chele ektu beshi pelo, acha, then you keep it little bit for the choto chele or major chele. Although major chele may say, I got lost in the shuffle.
Good. Now, you see, you're known for your, you know, quiet determination. You know, it's like quiet confidence, you know. You're determined, but not through exuberance, you know. Determined and quietly so. Where did you draw your strength from in the context of this big fight, the battle that you fought with the government? You know, at one point you needed to do that.
Yeah.
And you were determined from the very beginning. Lots of advice, lots of people said lots of things, but you're determined to pursue your course, your path, and you'd not sort of stray away from that. So where did you draw your strength and conviction from? Where do you do that?
So this is an interesting aspect of me, I think, that I'm beginning to realize about me, and I'll put that as a hypothesis to you, some of you that work with me and some of you that know me, and you can correct me if I'm right or wrong. So, and this is also has to something to do with management theory and management leadership that we all deal with. It has to do is decision making under uncertainty. And I think one of your speakers have talked about dealing in uncertain times. Now, when I went to Berkeley to do my operations research, one of the topic that I had to deal with was decision making under uncertainty. formal course that we took. And then I took a subsequent course on stochastic processes. And as a matter of fact, in SRI, my work focused with decision analysis. And one of the things you learned first thing was you can make good decision, and there are outcomes from those decisions. But even if you make a very good decision in a probabilistic adjusted basis, your outcome may be probabilistically good, but not always good. So you can have a failure. So the outcome is probability-wise influenced by how good the decision it is. To a point, I was given a blackjack problem to be solved as a homework problem. So I had to do that. And I learned the game of chance in that. In the markets, you can also see the game of chance playing out. So I had numerous opportunities to see good decision not lead to good outcomes. Samurai sword toiri korte gele, you heat it up and you pound it. Heat it, pound it, heat it, pound it. Now more pounding you get, stronger you get. So I probably, simulation-wise, probably got lot more pounding than average human being does. So I got detached from the outcome. I only focused on, did I make the right decision? So when you come back to these questions in my life, many things are glaring failures or glaringly the difficult outcome at that point of time. I have a way of saying, I will have to pursue this in a different way. New decisions, new approach, not be touched by temporary setbacks. So that may be your way of saying determination, my way of saying I need to make better decisions.
Yeah, well, PC, you know, what I meant was that, you know, when you launch yourself on a journey, and you talked about navigating without a map, you know, you said uncertain times, and that's a big need now these days, you know, because things are changing so fast. Look at the advance of technology and all of it, you know, nothing is static. So in that kind of a situation, you're actually navigating without a map, and every journey that you undertake, it is a journey of exploration, right? So in that kind of a situation, you see, if you take 100 decisions, I think the what is essential is that good or bad, you have to take a decision. But obviously, you don't go like a bull in a china shop. You explore, do dipsticks and so on and so forth. Now, if you've taken 100 decisions, just as a benchmark, how many decisions, 50% of them, if they are right, you say that you're a very good decision maker, you've done very well? Or is it, you know, 2 out of 10 decisions? A very rough kind of...
No, so this is an interesting situation, Ani. Even in a certain situations, and I'll use let's say the outcome is always going to be 1 in a million. Okay? So that means you have only 1 in a million chance of being right.
That's probability.
Now, that's probability. So you are, if you're going to play that game, if you go to play the roulette game, you know, your decision, the moment you entered the table or entered that aspect of life, you're going to fight for an election, you'd know there is 10 candidates, your chance of winning is 1 of 10. So sometimes whether the decision was 50% better or not, you cannot say from the point of view of the outcome. So you have to think about, was it a good decision? Sometimes the decision to fight an election could be Listen, I am preparing myself for the next election. This election is a way to build my reputation in the market, to give speeches, to connect with the people and make the mistakes so that in next election I am better prepared. So that's a very good decision, but result of that election would not judge the outcome does not judge the quality of the decision.
So therefore you strike a very fine balance between the quality of the decision and the fact that you take a decision.
See, many people invested and all of a sudden you get hit by COVID. Was the decision to invest was wrong? No. Nobody anticipated COVID will happen. But some people made fortunes out of COVID.
True. There's an opportunity. Yeah. This is something that has been always in my mind, and I'm sure many of you will resonate with that, is that given your stellar, absolutely stellar academic record, why did you choose business over academia and why management consulting over a technical occupation?
Bhagwan ja karen, mongoler jonnoi karen.
That is dodging the question, PC.
This is not the had I known that I'll get a Nobel Prize, maybe I would have chosen different decision. Actually, my first job that I got out of PhD was to go and teach in Cornell. And my professor said, please help me with this conference. And because of that request from him, I joined SRI in their decision analysis group. Now, that was a excellent, excellent fork in my journey that I took that as opposed to academia. Nothing wrong with academia. There's plenty wrong with academia also, but I don't want to get into as a career in academia. It's a wonderful career, but my journey through SRI to the, you always have to move with some flow. And I believe the good things happen if you're ordered at the age of order and chaos. And how do you bring little bit of chaos in your life?
I'll come to this.
Very, very important for the creative journey. Yes. If everything is well ordered, nothing good can come out of it.
So
I believe a little bit of a chaos is always needed.
Very good. Excellent. I remember you, saying this many, many times. And this is about the group that we run, that you run. You've said many times when I've questioned you, saying that, what is this? Seems to lack order. It seems to lack order. Now, you see, you are at the crossroads then, and you are actually saying that you chose the right path. You could have chosen the other one too, but that would have been equally successful for you. So you have no regrets that you probably did not take the right road then at the crossroad.
No, and I'll give you some color on that, why I feel that way. I think the road I chose allowed me to experiment with different things. Had I gone into academia, I will be in the publish or perish mode, keep on doing it. Hopefully I would have gotten out sometime. And that's why I probably am going back to academia now with my research center initiative to fulfill that desire. But this road has given me the opportunity to experiment with my own life, own curiosity, own ways of discovering different parts of the world.
Excellent. Now, for some of us who know you well, we see, you know, I have to say that you are a master juggler. What do I mean by that? You know, you have mastered the art of juggling multiple balls in the air at the same time. Hmm? So you got many balls in the air. And, you know, to most of us, that would spell chaos. So you were talking about chaos. That would spell chaos. But you appear to revel in complexities. You know, you're more comfortable with discomfort than with comfort. Is that right? I mean, you seem to enjoy the chaos, you know. Right?
Yeah.
You're more comfortable managing chaos than order. Is that right?
Well, you can say I'm looking for order in chaos. I'm not looking for order in order.
So if you went to the Big Bang, then it's a swirling mass of gases and dust, you know. And the whole universe is created out of the chaos. So are you actually saying that these sort of breakthroughs cannot be achieved without chaos?
Yeah, disruptions.
So this is the madness that you're talking about. There's no order in anything.
No, I think, you know, if you look at the world, look at the universe, look at biology, there's a self-organizing principle at work.
Mm.
You know, why did from that, you know, cloud, why did he evolve to a human living form? How do those chemistries self-organize to ATCG and today? That's all life form is out of that one equation. Why is the entropy is growing all the time, yet everything is stable? All this is part of your, you know, chaotic world self-organizing itself.
Yes. Right. So as Einstein, when he was asked, God, do you believe in God? And he said, I believe in God. If God was that force which maintained order in this chaos, you know. So is that right then? So is this order is really universal. Chaos is when something goes wrong. That's chaos.
No, I think, look, I do not know. I don't have Einstein's brain power, but what I do know, sitting back, over the 100 years since his, 17 years since theory of relativity, the world's understanding of the world, of humans' understanding of nature has evolved materially. And what Einstein did not have, the maths to figure it out and the tools to figure it out, is becoming more and more relevant. So he thought God could not leave so much uncertainty in the world, and yet God had created particle and matter. Everybody is saying now it's
wonderful.
Two are one and the same. So God has his way of divine, has his way. You know.
Good. So to you, that's divinity.
That's divinity. Self-organizing principle of chaotic world is the source of divinity.
But then in that case, it's not self-organizing really. What you're talking about, there's somebody behind the scenes who's organizing everything.
No, there's something is organizing it.
Something is organizing
it. Something is organizing it. Is it laws of physics, chemistry? We do not know. But it is something that is creates the all of universe to move forward. Well, second law of thermodynamics will teach you that entropy is growing, that means disorder is growing. But there is order out of that disorder. How is that happening? So those who have studied physics and all, to you it's well known. I'm just finding it out.
Yes, that's a perspective, a different one. You see, coming to something that you're very closely associated with, and which has taken a good bit of your, good part of your life, is your unwavering commitment to HPL. Unwavering commitment. At least I can say that from the point of view what I have seen. So, this has seen you through some of the most tumultuous times of your life. Some of the most tumultuous. If you say no, then maybe so, because I have not seen the other times. But this was certainly a very tumultuous time. Now, you could have easily taken the path of least resistance and walked away to your next project. And many advised you that as well. So, what made you persist with the battle, given the heavy odds against you? I mean, it was actually in a way crazy to say that I will actually, for my principles or whatever, or my determination, my conviction, I will take on the government, you know. Because I'm right. That's the strength of your conviction, right? So why didn't you walk away out of it and just persist? What were you trying to prove? Or were you saying that this is a jewel that I am going to pick up, polish, and make it gleam? What was it?
I wish I was my own psychologist to answer this question, right? But it's not that I haven't thought about this question before. And I don't have a very good answer as to why, and what are the alternate realities. But you know, when you do something, you get involved in it. So I got involved in Haldia. In a way, I did not know what I was getting involved in. It was a journey completely in fog. Okay? When I did not even see Haldia, I did not know how to spell petrochemicals. When I was approached and I come back to home and my mother says, you know, because there was some newspaper picture that showed that I am apparently talking to Honorable the then CM, Sri Jyoti Basu, about this project. And she said, is this something you can do? Now that probably triggered a different utility function in my mind than the normal utility function that you'll use to make a decision. So even though it was foggy, all the other parameters, I would have probably gone away saying, gee, you know, it's just too difficult. Greenfield plant in a communist state that has never seen a project of this kind, and I have no experience of doing it. Never done a greenfield project in my life. Why do it? And my partner is a hedge fund manager whose, you know, whole job is to get in and out in single flicker of a change in the bond interest rate. So, but that particular, maybe not even a request, it's kind of an, in a Bengali way of soft nudge. You know, if I didn't do it, my mother wouldn't be at all. I do not know. I never asked her the question because it is not something, because I did it anyway. So that got me going, and all the headwinds that came during the project execution, post-project execution, almost 94 to 2014, 20-year journey is not a normal businessman's career. It's no business. I mean, many people told me just walk out many times, and conventional business decision would have been that. So why I stuck around, many reasons, but many points. But I think in each of those points, I made the right decision. outcome just didn't happen the way I thought.
But PG, thereafter, I mean, as you said, at that time, you know, you, this rare display of passion, you went into this investment, and again, it was a journey of exploration, I'd say, because nothing much was known. In fact, there were all the uncertainties, you know, against you, the clouds, where the dark clouds had gathered.
Yeah.
Now, you, following that, you developed a very deep passion about catalyzing an industrial resurgence in bringing about an industrial resurgence in West Bengal, or in Bengal. While I know many who've espoused similar dreams, I want to know, did anybody in particular inspire you or germinate this idea in your mind that resurgence of West Bengal is something that you must contribute to? It's not just investing, but to bring about a discontinuity in what was happening in West Bengal.
I cannot think of any one individual, but I think, you know, obviously I am a product of various input that comes to me, but I think it's the right thing to do. And I also tell people that if I think I have some capabilities, if I don't do it, who do I tell that you should do it? I, as a Bengali, if I don't try to do it for Bengal, okay, I cannot tell. I can tell, of course, another Bengali to do it, but I cannot tell Elon Musk to come and do it.
So, but did people like Jyoti Babu, did people like Sadhan Dutta, did they sort of plant these germs in you that, you know, you have to do something for Bengal?
No, I think both Sadhan Babu,
as a business,
yeah, both Jyoti Babu and Sadhan Babu were very instrumental in getting me started or brought the topic of the Haldia investment at that time. And their pitch was also that, look, if, you know, Haldia doesn't happen, they were not looking at me doing Haldia, because, you know, it so happens at that point there was nobody else who was doing Haldia. So I think I was the last person that got involved in the Haldia picture. And I'm glad I was the last person to get involved, because I've stayed involved till now. Right. So I think they were looking at, of course, Haldia as a beginning of the industrial resurgence for Bengal at that point. So in that sense, you're right, is the role of Haldia is supersized in their mind, and I think in the mind of many people, and it's rightfully so.
Sure.
But Haldia alone cannot do everything. Haldia needs, many more Haldia are needed for 110 million people state of ours.
You see, what are your goals in investing in high-end education? Now you are investing in artificial intelligence, research, training. I know your interest, you know, your involvement in JBNSJS, how you were trying to sort of tweak the role of JBNSJS from just an agency which was giving scholarships to meritorious students, to actually how do you bring in methods of educating, beautiful minds. I mean, you were interested in saying that there are some special needs for special students, and how do you bring in that kind of training into education into India? Similarly, Kharagpur, you set up a lab. Then you were one of the founders of Indian School of Business,
So what is your ultimate goals in investing in higher education? What do you want to do? I mean, you want to bring up the level of education in India, or what is it? I do want the Indian people to become more productive.
So Ani, there are multiple threads going through my mind as I'm taking this piece of the journey in the form of CREST. CREST stands for Centers for Research and Education in Science and Technology, which is a new initiative, which culmination of many of the things that you mentioned before. One reason for me to do it is I'm interested in science and technology. It's sort of good, you know, reading and curiosity to know what's happening. But more importantly, I see CREST as a way of contributing in a meaningful way in the innovation ecosystem of the world. And by that I mean is, I think we're focusing on science and technology because disruptive changes are coming in the world through science and technology, whether it's for climate change, whether it's any kind of social problem, water problem, irrigation problem, on and on. And I think the supply of talent globally is far short of demand for talent. And that's the gap we're trying to fill by creating this PhD intensive education program in starting in Kolkata, but then going to wherever there is talent is, intense collaboration with people in Germany, in Silicon Valley, in Texas, wherever there is hub of innovation. We want CREST to be a significant player, not today. The journey is going to be long. It's a 200-300 year journey, but we think we can, just in AIML, which is a hot topic area, CREST can very easily produce 1,000 PhDs per year, and it'll be small compared to the global need. Similarly, in solid state battery research, quantum computing, there's about 20 areas where you can do, meet the supply of talent in a way that is significant. That's what CREST is all about. I like doing it. You can't, you know, again, Bhagavan's ichha, ami eta kori, tai ami korchi.
Vijay, I really don't know what you're not interested in, you know. I mean, it's very difficult to wrap my brains to find out what you're not interested in. If I give you a pin, you know, create something great out of that pin, you know, the possibility.
No, I can tell you, I'm not interested in politics.
Okay, right. So we're not going to talk about politics, but what is this bug that has bitten you once every now and then? You know, this is the media bug, you know. You are a media shy person. You are very publicity shy. There are many in this room today from the media who will agree and wholeheartedly agree to that. Eh? You like to maintain a very low profile. You want people to know you by your deeds rather than by, you know, through your expositions. But at the same time, your first, as you said, your first entrepreneurial venture while at IIT Kharagpur was to make viable a campus media project. Then later in your life, you created another media venture, and that fascinated you. That was Bangla Life. You wanted a Facebook version of this thing of Bangla Facebook version with blogging and all of that, you know. So once you were at it, you're still at it, I think, you know. So you created this Bangla Life.
Sorry? No, it's in a sleepy mode.
Okay. But so why is this media, you know, how does this media excite you from time to time?
No, that
why?
Portion
is it
you have two questions there. I find it, why do I get involved in media projects and why am I media shy? So I'll answer both of those. Media project I get involved is because of my curiosity. Is the last media project, quote unquote media project we did, was Satyajit Ray's Kheror Khata of Gupiga and Bhagavain. We put it up in a searchable form so that people can see what the maestro thought and what the maestro did. And this is an interesting way for people to do research on the mind of the maestro and nature of entertainment and all that. That's a reason I do media projects. Why am I media shy? Very simple. As you can see, I'm a confused personality. Okay? And media likes to have very crisp one-liner. And I would be misinterpreted because even I cannot interpret myself. So why be, you know, subject myself to be misinterpreted knowingly? That's simple.
That's a simple reason.
That's a simple reason.
Is that a complicated one? Is there another complicated one? No.
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 No, I said that it is that simple.
Right. You see, you amongst the various people you've come in touch with, who've helped you, influenced you in your life, catapulted you on your path to, entrepreneurship. Where would you put George Soros? You're very close to him. He is referred to you in his books also. How did it, what role has it played you ultimately in your propelling you into entrepreneurship?
You know, if you look at the tapestry that of anybody's life that gets built on a life is like a painting, right? George Soros's contribution in the painting that I am trying to create as I walk around life is very, very significant. I think through my association, I came to know the world of macro investments, how the ebbs and flows of currencies and interest rates and everything happens, and how those things again influence micro decisions in various ways. So I learned a lot from that. One particular incident I'll tell you that I still carry in my mind. George at one time said, PC, sometimes, most times, you investigate and then you invest. So we do our due diligence and then you pull the trigger. That's a normal approach, even in buying and selling stocks. He said, there will come sometimes when you invest before you investigate. Okay? Why? Because by the time you investigate, many other people have investigated and thereby you have no advantage in the market. So you go with your gut feel and just punt. I sometimes do that. Okay. So
that is very, very enlightening.
It's a very profound teaching of a very, very intelligent, successful, worldly, humanitarian philanthropist that I know of.
You see, you were one of the youngest partners in McKinsey, sir. You were at that time. And you led, while in your stint with McKinsey, you led several strategic and organizational assignments for companies around the world. But despite this meteoric rise in McKinsey, why did you call it quits? Because at that time he wanted to change.
I joined McKinsey for 2 years. I stayed there 8-9 years. I was having fun. I was learning business, which I never learned before. And then it came a time saying, I want to see whether my advice is any good or not. And the only way to do that is to be an entrepreneur. So that's how I bought a small company and started my journey.
I remember, you see, once I asked you in several chats that you have had, sometimes in the cold winter Delhi, going through a heavily cordon road with people, you know, with their AK-47 popped up, and you know, we are having a conversation and walking on the road, you know, mist. I said, PC, it requires one trigger happy guy to just pull the trigger, you know, remember? And you still engage, and sometimes you said some things which are very profound, you know. And I wanted to know, and you said many things that I remember, but for this conversation, today's conversation, I wanted to know what, according to you, has been singularly the most satisfactory achievement or experience of your professional life? Maybe one or two? Gave you the biggest, in your sense, of satisfaction?
I don't know.
Haldia?
Yeah, Haldia is, you know, it's probably, again, battle hardened me the most of all things I have done. So in that sense, you know, if a samurai was using me, he would say that was a good kashai ghar, you know.
You see, I have not come across many people who travel as much as you do, and although it is largely for work. Now, you must have notched up, you know, phenomenal AMIs. Now, where do you find the time to pursue your own interests rather than work? You're not known to be an avid reader. You read, but mostly serious stuff, you know. You're not a keen golfer who will spend every weekend wasting his time chasing one ball from one hole to another. You know, you're not a known sports person. So, what do you do for fun? You must have some fun. What do you do for fun?
I'm, my work is fun and fun is work, right? It's, there is, you know, even when I'm on vacation, I'm talking to somebody or the other somewhere. So I don't distinguish, life just moves. It's not, I don't take these things that I do as quote-unquote work. If I did, when we were talking about that, I do a lot of multiplexing and juggling and all that. I don't find this to be juggling or stressful juggling. I find them to be, you know, this, that. And every day, there's something good and something bad is happening. And you have the mind has a way of only focusing on the good thing that's happened, so I fall asleep.
Be as preoccupied as you've been with your work, whether you use for fun or for whatever, but it's been work at the end of the day. Do you feel that you've been able to devote enough quality time to your family?
No.
No?
No.
Regrets?
I think, my sense is it's all Bhagavaner Ichcha. You know, if I take standard measures of work-life balance, I don't have it. Okay? But I do not know too many people that actually have that. There are periods of time when I have intense time with my family, but if I look at it, 38 years that I'm married with my dear wife, are we seeing eye to eye all the time? Are we doing vacations, you know, going on the Antarctica for 2 months and all that? That's not me. You know, I think she knows that. She accepts me for what I am. My daughter accepts me now. Was not very happy at one time. She used to say, "Oh, Dad is always on the phone." So, so I think, you know, it's life.
So therefore, you know, let me ask you this question. You know, we're now coming to the end of the session. If somebody gave you a chance to live your life all over again, as you mean, God said, "Well, now PC, you're going to be born again and have another life." What chapters of your life would you like to rewrite, except for the fact that you would probably want to be plugged into the same family, be Amita's husband, Kya's father? Apart from that, what are the chapters of your life you would want to rewrite, you know, or redo?
No, the one journey I am not able to take, if I am, and based on the experience I have today, that I wouldn't mind, is to experience a lifelong pursuit of a monastic life.
Monastic life? Yeah. Wow.
You know, to be a, you know, like, I cannot, you know, you can only use models out there to, suppose, why not life of Sri Aurobindo or, you know, a Ramakrishna Mission Shivayat. So this is a journey into a different world of contemplation.
Is this your next dream project?
Well, in this life it would not happen. They would not take me.
Right.
You had to join them when I was leaving Narendrapur.
Right. So, ladies and gentlemen, to wrap up this fabulous tete-a-tete, I'd like to share with you all three quotes which I've written down here, which deeply resonate with PC's outlook of life. But this is from my own perspective. Having spent close to 10 years with him, you know, this is how I see him, through three quotes. The first one is, one must still have chaos in oneself to be able to give birth to a dancing star. Did you get that sense when you answered the questions? Well, I have for many years. The second outlook, or the second element of his outlook, that, you know, the big picture, is dwell in possibility. Think about it. PC dwells in possibility. I have never seen him in a situation where anything is impossible. So he dwells only in possibility. For him, there is no impossibility. There is no impossible situations. And he has demonstrated that. And the last one is that life is a firm belief. His firm belief that life doesn't put things in front of you that you are unable to handle. Is that right? If you reflect on it, do you think that's true for many of you too? Right? So, these three quotes, and last one in particular, reflects the philosophy of the man I have been talking to today. Now, you see, we know that you prefer to let your work speak for itself rather than appear for countless interviews and appearances and so on and so forth. So I'd like to thank you for agreeing to share with us a side of you that not many of us were familiar with. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Chatterjee. Thank you, Mr. Lahiri. May I now request Mr. Shubhi Chakraborty, President Designate the Bengal Chamber and MD and CEO Excite Industries Limited, to kindly deliver the vote of thanks. Over to you, sir.
Dr. Chatterjee, Mr. Lahiri, and the audience. Mr. Lahiri started off the session saying that it will be a fun session. To my mind, I think when somebody of the stature of Mr. Lahiri talks to an iconic personality like Dr. Chatterjee, I think the intellectual energy is almost palpable in the air. I felt it, and I'm more than sure that most of you would have felt it as well. It started off with general discussions, but later on we came to topics bordering on philosophy, and Dr. Chatterjee actually dished out a primer on decision analysis and stochastic processes as well. So that was extremely stimulating intellectually for most of us. So thank you, Dr. Chatterjee, for sparing your valuable time with us. Personally, I wish someday, sometime, I can spare 1 hour with you just talking about the various subjects that you have discussed today. So thank you once again. Mr. Aniruddha Lahiri is one of us. He was the former president of this chamber, and my thanks to him for conducting this session in a way which really made it very, very interesting. May I now please call upon Mr. Arnob Basu, Vice President of the Bengal Chamber, to hand over a memento to Mr. Aniruddha Lahiri, former president, for moderating the day's session with Dr. Chatterjee. Last but not the least, sincere thanks to all our partners who made this session possible, and to this wonderful audience which listened to every word of Dr. Chatterjee with rapt attention. So thank you once again, and please join us for lunch at the Bengal Lounge on the third floor. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.